Hi, I'm Christina Shiano, and this is Bridge the Atlantic.
Hey, how's it going? For Bridge the Atlantic, I'm singer-songwriter Marcy Novelli from Canada.
And I'm music web designer Russ Barber-Smith from Scotland.
And you're watching Encore, a show featuring advice for musicians from the industry's finest. If you're new here, subscribe.
And we are joined by Christina Shiano.
So Christina, based on your experience as a session drummer, we'd love to hear about what makes a session successful. You know, what do you do personally to prepare, and what would you expect from the other musicians involved?
To be successful, I would honestly say you have to put your ego down, because it's not your band. You're just working for them, which is something that I had to teach myself over time, because the first session I did, I'm just like, no, guys, this is what we should be doing. And then I spoke to some friends and they're just like, no, don't do that. So, just listen to them. Obviously, you have to put your input in there if you genuinely think something will work better. But I would just say go with the flow. But you also have to kind of stand your ground if something that they want just doesn't sound good, because you are putting your own name on that. Like, if I'm recording for this so-and-so band and my name's going to be in the credits, I would like the drums to sound nice. So that's definitely something that I would say that would make it successful. It would make your experience way better if you know, you go in the clear head and everything too.
So it's not your band, it's not your release, you're going in to serve someone else.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's kind of, I think it would be kind of like an actor in a film. Everyone looks at the actors as the main, you know, talent, which of course they're, you know, unbelievable talent in the acting world, but really they are there to serve the vision of the writers and the director and the producers. You know, they're bringing in their talents and in their own, you know, suggestions and everything, but at the end of the day, it's not their work.
Exactly. They have to listen to the other people.
Right. Yeah. And as an artist myself, I play everything except for drums, and I've worked with a few different drummers. There have been a particular couple of drummers that are just fantastic. It's like, what do you want from me? You know, and I give them an idea and I'm basically saying, make this better, you know, or take this idea and run with it. And I always give that freedom a little bit to be like, well, you know, what do you think, you know? But I've had a couple of drummers where it was just like, no, it's got to be like this. It's like, but it's my record and I don't like it. It's like,
exactly.
That's not cool. And, you know, I guess you can probably guess which ones I've brought back to work on future recordings. You know what I mean? I guess in the session world, are you looking to play in a band someday? Like, what are you looking for?
I would love to be in a band. Like, I would love to write my own music, do all that. But I'm actually totally opposite. Well, not really totally opposite. I would love to move more towards actual production work. Like the Yamaha commercial I did, I want to do more video shoots like that rather than going on tour and doing all that. Even though I would love to go on like my first tour, just because I would love to go on tour.
Right.
But yeah, definitely more production work, and even behind the scenes is what I'm trying to get into now.
As a musician who posts covers online, how do you choose the material that you want to perform? You know, what advice could you offer to other musicians who want to start recording and posting covers, but kind of look at all the possibilities out there and don't know where to begin?
For people starting to post covers, I would say you have to kind of choose the songs that are on the radio, and choose what's popular and what people are actually YouTubing. But once you actually establish a fan base and you're comfortable with the number, kind of just do whatever you want, which is what I made that switch. I started covering what I want. But now I actually take requests. Like, I'd say the last 15 covers I did were just because of what people were requesting. So I just read the comments and I just see what name keeps popping up over and over again, and then I'll just cover it.
Do you still kind of keep an eye on the charts at all within any genre, just to kind of every now and then say, yeah, I want to do this and kind of...
I actually haven't covered a new song in quite a long time, just because I don't really like what's on the radio. So I went back to like throwback punk songs like Green Day and My Chemical Romance, and it just seemed to stick. So yeah, that's what I'm in, that kind of mode right now. I would love to get into new stuff once, you know, I actually start liking what's out.
And one thing that I'm curious about, when people are requesting songs that are maybe not in the kind of genre that you would normally play, do you find it's like a good learning experience and you kind of challenge for you to pick up maybe some different styles that you wouldn't probably do otherwise?
It is. I got a lot of requests for Avenged Sevenfold over the past like year and a half, and I just kept putting it off because I don't listen to them. It's not the music I play. But then I'm just like, you know what? Let me challenge myself and just expand a little bit. which is what I did. And I honestly love this song. I loved playing to it. So now I'm even moving into heavier music now. And that was just because I finally jumped into what they were requesting.
And do you find that doing these covers for all these years has made you a better drummer?
Yeah, definitely. It made me practice. Because I had like a schedule. I had to learn a song every week, every 2 weeks. So at least for that amount of time, I was practicing. So it definitely helped.
And just quickly, we know what your schedule is when you post online, but what's kind of your schedule behind the scenes with that? You know, like, do you bulk? Do you batch record? Like, what do you do?
It's just, I work on one video at a time just because my brain just can't handle anything else. I basically work like 10 to 12 hours a day. Every single day. I don't really have weekends off. And that's just based off of my schedule. I'm my own boss, but that's just the schedule I give myself. So yeah, I just do one video at a time. It'll take me maybe a couple days to learn it. And then the day of, I will record, edit, and post it the same day. So those days are always, it's like a zoo in my house, just trying to get everything done. But yeah. And then right after that, I'll just start learning a new song.
So how many days or how many hours do you think you put into each cover?
I'd say depending on the difficulty level, I'd say the average is maybe 3 to 4 days. It's not bad.
It's not too bad considering the outcome that you've gotten from it. So it's not too bad.
Like my more successful videos, those were like, I just learned it the day I recorded it. And it's just like, wow. Some videos I had to practice for like 2 weeks for like the harder ones. Yeah. Not as successful, but when I just kind of wing it, it just worked.
We hope you enjoyed this encore episode. For more from Brazilantic, find us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And if you want to pick up one of our shirts, visit our website and use coupon code BTARocks and you will receive 20% off your order.
This episode was brought to you by Social Surge, your source for social media marketing and online music promotion. Check them out because they do our us.
They keep this show alive. And if you would like to sponsor the show and become an official Bridger, join us on Patreon from as little as $1 per month. Not only will you be able to showcase your band or brand to our amazing audience, but your support will allow us to keep bringing you weekly videos here at Bridge the Atlantic.